at Shackleton from Australian Potash. Matt, good morning.
Hi, Andrew. Good to see you again.
And you, Matt. You had this update, a comparison summary out this week on the Lake Wells sulphate of potash project. Give us an overview of the announcement here.
What we're doing here, Andrew, obviously, there's been a couple of early movers in the peer space, and things haven't gone particularly smoothly for those movers. So what we're trying to do here, and I think legitimately Australia Potash is probably considered to be the third of the early movers. What we're doing here is we're just setting out the essential elements of these operations and where we sit in terms of strategically and strategic choices about how we're developing into those particular elements. I mean, across brine, supply, evaporation ponds and processing, and they're the three essential technical components of these operations. Australian Potash is able to differentiate the Lake Wells SOP project very clearly on brine supply. We're 100% borefield operation, so we have no reliance on any trenching networks for our brine supply. And we are in a situation where we don't have to use trenching. And the fact is we haven't seen any evidence that the trenching model actually works for brine supply. We've seen plenty of evidence that borefield developments work for brine supply. So we chose the lower risk pathway and chose to develop a brine borefield as opposed to a brine trench network. That's the big differentiator, and we're 100% trenching, borefield, I should say, which makes us unique in the entire SOP space here in WA. The evaporation pond model, that bit in the middle, that's the essential. The most important part of these operations is the evaporation network that you develop. We are all of us solar salt operators here in Western Australia, or looking to be solar salt developers, I should say, therefore. And it's absolutely vital, that evaporation step in the middle. And being able to control that is paramount to your success. Now, it's our view that controlling the environment, that's beyond all of us, but controlling the flow and the volume of brine in your evaporation network is the only lever you've really got to speed up and slow down your evaporation rate. It's a very coarse lever, but it's the only one we have. Now, in order to enable that lever to be used, you again have to have a steady, consistent supply of brine. We don't see any evidence that the trenching networks can do that, but we do see evidence that the borefield networks can do that. And finally, on the processing flow sheet, the flow sheets that are being promoted by all of the developers and the early movers, they will work. They have been designed by process engineers who know a lot more about this than I do, for sure. But so they will work. The question is whether or not the processing plants have been built with the tolerances to cope with variable feed salt qualities, for example. Now, therein lies the trick. What we've chosen to do, again, on a low-risk pathway, is we've made sure that our engineers are based here in Perth. And our engineers have got experience with the style of contract, EPC, and with building SOP process plants. And they're just down the road from us. So we've got access, we believe, to the skill base that's going to allow us to develop our plant as and when we need it. So I think what ultimately, to summarise all of that, Andrew, what we're trying to do is not portray ourselves as the no-risk option, but we do want to emphasise that we have for a long time been considering the lowest risk development options in all three of those major components. And we've been speaking to it for a long time. It's been proven that trenching doesn't seem to work here with SOP projects. It's now been proven and shown demonstrably that controlling your evaporation pond network is vital and key and the most vital part of the success of these operations. So overall, we've positioned ourselves, we think, quite nicely at the lower risk end of the development spectrum.
You mentioned some of the wobbles experienced by the early movers. As a result, investor sentiment in the potash space has taken a knock. Do you expect to see that turn?
Well, we do. We most certainly do. What investors and probably the broader market need to remember here is that uniquely Western Australia has got 4 or 5 commercial primary deposits of sulphate potash. And that is unique across the globe. We have the ability and we are positioned to become a globally significant potash province in Western Australia. There is no doubt that at least 2 and potentially 3 or 4 of these operations will get developed and will be profitable and go for multi-generational life of mine. And in that scenario, Western Australia will be central for the supply of sulphate of potash. We can potentially control, you know, up to 20-25% of the global supply of sulphate of potash, which is an enormous market share to have, an enormous influence to have in that market, very profitable market. And that's what is going to happen in Western Australia. And it is inevitable these things will happen. We are able to produce the lowest cost on the cost of production curve. We are logistically situated ideally into near the fastest growing demand market for SOP. And we have the luxury of already having sulphate brines that contain high levels of potassium in them. So I think if there's one overarching message, notwithstanding some of the, you know, the hurdles that a couple of the early movers have faced and the challenges that they've faced, and hats off to Kalium Lakes who are getting over these challenges. The message there to remember is that all new industries and all new developments, and this is a new industry, a new subsector of the mining industry in Western Australia, they do take time. There are a few hiccups. Let's not forget the nickel laterite industry, which is now an enormously profitable industry for Western Australia. But the first two movers in that industry had some problems. It took a couple of years to get over those, to get the technology right, to get to iron out the hiccups and so on. But again, that industry settled down to be a rock solid industry, excuse the pun. That is where we think the SOP industry is going in Western Australia. A couple of early speed wobbles, but we're ironing them out. We're all learning from them, and we're redesigning our development and operational strategies as a result. So time will tell, but WA is about to become a powerhouse in potash.
Well, Matt, give us an update. What's happening on site as far as the project? What news is around the corner from you?
So our development schedule, we've now drilled and developed 20 of the 79 production wells that we need in our startup and operational strategy. We are still pursuing the debt position. We're still pursuing our development equity. There's no doubt about that. Look, in the likely event that we're able to make a final investment decision over the balance of this half, we've got a development timeline that sees us producing feed salts into our processing plant 27 months from the time we start pumping into our first ponds. So that's where we're at. That's the target that we're still aiming for. Our critical path has been preserved through all of this, so we're still on track. And we're still looking to start production 2023 and be fully ramped up through 2024.
Good to see you, Matt. Thanks for your time.
Good to see you again too, Andrew. Take care.